thank you all for getting up early this morning and being here for this conversation. We've had a really good day here yesterday. My colleague Brittany Collins and I were with the City Council, the mayor, senior staff for their retreat, and they saw virtually the same presentation. So for some of you, Rodney, you might be able to do this now, that this is the second time you have seen it. But I wanted to start first by saying, we are so impressed with what you have all done in terms of looking straight at the hard facts of concentrated poverty and thinking about what we need to do together as a community to create opportunities that will allow families to break the cycle of poverty. This is one model that I'm going to share with you. There are other ways to get there, and you may decide that some of those other ways are better ways, but this is what we know how to do and where we've had really good success in Atlanta, where we're having good success around the country, and it's up to you to decide whether or not this is an approach that makes sense in Norfolk. So let's just kind of start with where we are. I think this is a group that is pretty familiar with some of these real sobering statistics around poverty. 50 years after Lyndon Johnson declared a war on poverty, we have won some battles, but not yet the war. Almost 50 million Americans continue to live in poverty. That's more than one in 10. I think the figure I saw in Norfolk, it was 16.5% of families live in poverty. So you've got a higher concentration of poverty in this city than in other parts of the country. Certainly not the highest, but it's above the national average. We also know that poverty impacts children more acutely than it impacts adults, and that children who grow up in poverty have a harder row to hoe than children who do not. We also know that children who grow up in concentrated poverty have the hardest challenges to move forward. Doesn't mean they can't. It just means the odds are stacked against them. What we want to do is think about a model that turns that upside down and creates the opportunity where the average child can reach his or her full potential, rather than just the exceptional or the exceptionally lucky children. We care at Purpose Built particularly about these neighborhoods of concentrated poverty. Those are the neighborhoods that we're most interested in, where we think this model can make a real difference for kids who grow up in neighborhoods of concentrated poverty. I want you to focus on this factor. This is 86% of low-income kids who live in concentrated poverty do not read at grade level in third grade. 86%. This is about the most important early statistic, early warning signal, or early signal of success about whether a child, a school, a community are on track for good academic outcomes, good economic outcomes, and as we know more and more, good health outcomes. This is a really important factor, and I encourage you to be monitoring this in your communities as you're working to move forward. If kids are reading at grade level in third grade, they are much more likely to be successful than if they're not. But we see across the country, if you live in concentrated poverty, 6 out of 7 kids are not reading at grade level. So the social justice aspect of this work moves me. But it may be some people respond more to the economic elements of this. We lose $500 billion a year in economic output as a result of childhood poverty. $500 billion every year, year in, year out. Think about this, what it was about 7 years ago when Congress passed the TARP. And I expressed no opinion on whether the TARP was good or bad, but it was $700 billion once that was going to all be repaid. And remember the outrage. Where is the outrage over on this issue? $500 billion a year that we lose as a result of childhood poverty. If you think about Social Security, when Social Security first started in the 1930s, there were 150 workers to every recipient of Social Security. Today there are 3. When I retire in 2030, there will be 2. And 50% of those workers will be black and brown. We need, as an economic imperative for our country, every single person in our country to be educated, to be a lifelong learner in a knowledge-based economy if we hope to maintain our own standards of living and move forward. If you had asked me 5 years ago whether I was in the health outcomes business, I would have said, hell no, I'm a community developer. If you ask me that today, I say, hell yes, I'm a community developer. We did not appreciate the connection between health outcomes and community work. In fact, I used to conflate health care with health. But now I understand, I have been educated and I have drunk the Kool-Aid on this, that if we think about health outcomes, 10% of our health outcomes are tied to the quality of medical care we receive, just 10%, but that's where we spend all the money. 30% are tied to our genes, just the luck of the draw, who our parents were, the genes that we bring to the table. 60% of health outcomes are tied to our environment and our behavior. And that's what we do as community developers. We impact environment and behavior, and as a result, we're impacting health outcomes. So health in this country doesn't equal health care. It's an important part of it, but it doesn't equal health care. Health equals the neighborhood where you live, it equals your income, and it equals your education. So those are the things that we think on in terms of creating an equal playing field for health outcomes. You've probably all seen this chart. This is Raj Chetty's chart that looks at social mobility. So the likelihood of being born in the bottom 20% of the economic spectrum in this country, what's your likelihood of moving to the top within your lifespan? If you are born in Atlanta, it's only a 4% chance, if you're born in the bottom, that you move to the top 20% in your lifetime. It's not much better in Norfolk. There's some areas in the country, some of these little blue areas up there, I think that's where they're doing all the fracking, which is a whole other conversation. So, you know, if you're born here, you're born here, the likelihood of you moving forward is low. It's really low. We need to change that upside down. That is not the American dream right here. The economists now say, if you want to live the American dream, move to Finland. We can do better than this. We must do better than this. This is a slide that VCU produced recently looking at health outcomes. And you can see within 5 miles of downtown Richmond, there's a 20-year discrepancy in life expectancy based on your neighborhood. Neighborhood matters. They have not yet produced a slide for Norfolk, but when they do, I think this is exactly the same pattern that you will see. Talk about a social justice and economic issue, life expectancy. So purpose-built communities, let me tell you a little bit about us. We care about all of these issues, and our goal is to combat these issues and create great neighborhoods that are launch pads for children and families so everyone can reach their full potential. Purpose-built started in 2009 as a result of the success of the revitalization of the Eastlake neighborhood. I realized that a month ago, I celebrated my 20th anniversary working on the Eastlake project, 20 years. And I will say that this work is long-term work. It's not a 3-year grant and you're out. It's a long-term commitment to community, a long-term commitment to neighborhood, and it is staying the course. And as a result of that long focus, the staying the course, we have got some great outcomes. And I want to share the Eastlake story with you because that's the basis for our work today. So our work is place-based and people-centered. It's not one or the other. We think place matters, environment matters, and if you create great, healthy places, you can build pathways out of poverty in them for the lowest income families. So here's Eastlake back in 1995. It looks familiar, doesn't it? You can look out the window and see places that look a lot like this. Eastlake Meadows was a public housing community with 650 apartments on 54 acres. The crime rate was 18 times the national average. Almost everybody was going to be the victim of a felony every year. And Andy Young used to say that the only time the haves and have-nots came together in Eastlake was over the $35 million a year drug trade. The housing stock was 100% public housing. But only a little bit more than half of the apartments by the mid-1990s were habitable. Most of them no longer met HUD's very basic habitability standards. When the units were first built in the late 1960s and early 70s, they were not well built. So within 2 weeks of families moving in, sewage was backing up into the units because it had been done on the cheap. Everything about it was done in a way that said to the people who live there, you don't matter, you're not important, and this is good enough for you. I mean, I cannot think of something more offensive than the message that was sent to families about this kind of housing stock. Hardly anybody worked, even though the Atlanta economy was extraordinarily strong in the mid-1990s. Only 13% of adults worked. Average incomes were well under $5,000, and almost everybody relied on welfare as their primary source of income. But it was around education that was the most sobering. When we collectively looked at these statistics and saw that only 5% of fifth graders could pass the state math test, that only 30% of young people were graduating from high school. And the reality is those young people were not well prepared for college or career. And that the longer kids stayed in the schools that were serving this neighborhood, the further behind their peers they fell. And so this is what we walked into. I was a new lawyer who came to work for the Atlanta Housing Authority in 1995. I was hired to create the legal and financial model to do mixed income housing. But our agency was very broken back then, very broken. We were on HUD's Troubled Housing Authority list. And we had gotten a new executive director a few months before I joined, and which is really the reason I joined, because she was a really talented, remarkable person. And I thought, I want to be where she is. I want to be where that leader is. And so I joined up. And if you go to an agency that's really broken on the beginning of a recovery, and you demonstrate the least little bit of enthusiasm and talent, it's like being in a startup. You get to do a lot of things that are outside your normal job description. And that happened to me. So 2 weeks in, Renee Glover walks into my office and she says, you're coming with me out to Eastlake. And I said, oh, Renee, you've clearly confused me with somebody else. I'm your deal lawyer. And she looked at me and she said, there's nobody else home. Our bench is not deep. You need to come with me. And that changed the course of my life, both personally and professionally. Becoming part of the planning committee, working on that revitalization, getting to know the residents, building relationships. I ultimately worked on planning committees on 13 different projects. So I had a chance to get to know people all over Atlanta, but worked most closely in Eastlake because, frankly, it was the hardest of all the ones that we had to work in because of the really desperate situation, some complicated politics, and the fact that we had such a strong resident leader in Eva Davis. And you'll hear from her in just a minute. So we did a 3-year planning process involving the residents of Eastlake Meadows, senior leaders of the Atlanta Housing Authority, and this new group called the Eastlake Foundation, which was created by a local foundation called the Cousins Family Foundation. I have to tell you, I didn't understand what the Eastlake Foundation was, and honestly, I didn't quite trust them on the front end because I had never seen that kind of generosity or philanthropy in action before. I had been a real estate lawyer, and I had worked with lots of real estate developers, and I did not know them as a group to be a generous breed. And so it took me a while, it took me almost 3 years to believe that the Eastlake Foundation was here because what the work needed to be done and that people deserve, they really believed that people deserved every single opportunity that the founder had experienced in his life. So the Eastlake Foundation, the residents, and the Housing Authority planned together for 3 very difficult years, building trust, building relationships, coming up with a master plan saying, if we could start over, what would we do? Now, housing was the most acute need in the community, and the Housing Authority had some money, so we started planning there. The residents were insistent upon mixed income housing, and everybody else agreed with that. Ms. Davis had a real vision of wanting to have a mixed income community, a racially and economically diverse community. And so mixed income housing was a way to start to create the platform to get there. It was a difficult process. The residents ultimately voted in favor of this thing that had never been done before and moving forward. I want you to hear from Eva Davis for just a sec. I've been sharing a little bit about some of the resident planning. We could spend all day talking about the planning process and how important it is. And I would say I'd like to put a pin in that. And if you'd like to talk about that more later, I'm happy to do that. But I want you to see the entire model first. Here's for Eva Davis.
2 guys got in a fight right across in front of my house. I saw one peep his head around the corner. Pow, pow, pow. It was just like you was in a movie, Western movie.
Eva Davis moved into Atlanta's Eastlake Meadows housing project in 1971. It wasn't long before murder and mayhem became a way of life.
He ran right by my car and blood was just shooting out of his body. That guy shot him and he fell dead right before my face.
The 650-unit housing project was never great, but when drugs took over and gangs claimed turf, it went from bad to horrible in a hurry.
They would shoot and cut and stab and kill each other. That's what they did.
By 1995, the crime rate was 18 times the national average. This was Eastlake 10 years ago, and this is Eastlake today. Torn down, rebuilt, utterly transformed. Clean, safe, family-friendly.
This was a pretty hellish place.
Pretty?
And now?
Is heaven.
Miss Davis used to say that we tore down hell, built heaven, and now we're living in paradise. If she was still living, she died 3 summers ago. If she was still living, she'd be here with me having this conversation. There was no one who is a more effective advocate for this kind of community revitalization than Eva Davis. She still has 2 daughters and probably 50 grands and great grands who live in the neighborhood who are living out her legacy now. So here we are today, 15 years later. Let me show you some of the data. So crime is down dramatically, down over 70% overall on violent crime, or 90% on violent crime, 70% overall. What was the most dangerous, most violent precinct in Atlanta is now among the safest. The housing stock has been replaced with high quality mixed income. In our case, mixed income is 50% public housing assisted, 50% market rate. Every building is 50-50. You cannot tell based on where somebody lives whether they receive a rent subsidy. Now, I would not recommend that anybody do the 50-50 mix. That was a political accommodation that Ms. Davis negotiated. There are more sophisticated models to think about the income mix. But the idea is right, creating housing that serves people across a really broad range of incomes. Everybody works. There is a lease requirement in your lease, whether you receive public housing assistance or you're paying market rents. Everybody works. Now, when families lose their job, because we know it's a tough world and people get fired or they get laid off, as long as you get back up on the horse and start working to look for work or get in a job training program, you don't lose your housing. In 15 years, we've never evicted anybody for not working. People want to work. Sometimes they need help and they need support, but families want to work, and we've been successful helping with them. In fact, the people who receive public housing assistance, their incomes are 5 times higher than they were back in 1990 or 1995. Now, they're still extremely low income, but they're working, and that's a huge transition. But it's around education that we're most excited. Now we're seeing the kids who live in our community thrive and doing really well in school. In fact, there are 1,706 children now who go to the neighborhood charter school that's now one of the highest performing schools in the state of Georgia, and we'll see a little bit more data there. 98% of kids meet or exceed state standards while remaining true to be a school that serves primarily low-income kids and kids who live in the neighborhood. So, I went to work for the Eastlake Foundation in 2001 and thought I had the easiest job in America after having been at the Housing Authority for 6 years. You know, we used to say 1 year at the Housing Authority was like 7 years in other people's lives. So I had done my 49 years and I thought I had an easy job because my job now was to make sure all these people work together. And I thought, gosh, they're all in the same place. Of course they're all going to work together. Well, one of the first things I learned is that co-location does not mean collaboration or coordination. And that my job as the head of the Eastlake Foundation became, how do we make all these pieces work together so that families move forward? And that's what we did. Let me show you some of the data. We had to look back. We had, oh gosh, almost 2,000 people a year coming to visit us in the mid-1990s, late 1990s, because we were doing good. And people said, this is really cool. We want to do it too. Well, we couldn't just say we did everything. So we had to take a step back and say, what were the key strategies that we did? What did it look like? And so we realized that there was a very clear approach to what we did. And I want to share that with you now. First, this was a neighborhood effort. It wasn't citywide. It wasn't regional. It was a deep dive into a geography. It was place-based, neighborhood-centered. Within that neighborhood, we did 3 strategies simultaneously and over a 10-year period. First, we replaced the distressed public housing with high-quality mixed-income housing, housing that would no longer isolate, warehouse, and stigmatize low-income families. Second, we built a cradle-through-college education pipeline that started with really high-quality early learning that moves seamlessly into a great K-12 experience and now prepares every single child in the community for success in a 4-year college and beyond. And then the third strand was on community wellness. And again, not just thinking about the delivery of health care, but health and wellness writ large. And as a result, you know, it's YMCAs, branch banks, grocery stores, community gardens, all those kinds of things that, when knitted together, create an ecosystem that support families on their journey forward. But here's our secret sauce, the idea of a community quarterback, a single purpose nonprofit whose only reason for existence is to coordinate all this work, to make sure that the community vision that has been created by the neighborhood is in fact implemented by all the parties who are necessary in order to do it. Let me show you what this looks like. So first, a neighborhood. So here's on the left-hand side of the screen. Maybe that's the left hand, maybe it's the right, I can't tell the difference. This little part, this is the part of Atlanta that we're talking about. We're talking about a really small area. This little appendage right here is this orange block, about 175 acres. A deep dive into a small geography. We stole kind of the idea of placemaking from the real estate development world and concentrated the development of the physical resources in a small geography to create what feels like a really healthy place with great kind of sizzle, if you know what I mean, a place where people want to be. And we concentrated there and it spread out all over here. So this area up here, there hadn't been a building permit issued in 27 years before we started. That was a neighborhood of extraordinary disinvestment. But by creating great things here, including great housing, great education, great health and wellness, it stimulated the private market to invest here in neighborhoods that had been completely disinvested for 50 years. There was $200 million of additional investment that we didn't have anything to do with in just the first 10 years. I haven't updated these statistics. I have a feeling if we did that today, it might be double that. But what we did is, you know, again, there's never going to be enough government and philanthropic money to create all the kinds of neighborhoods that we want to see with the assets that we want to see. We've got to stimulate the private market to want to invest in neighborhoods that have been disinvested. And that's what we try to do. So mixed income housing, the first strand of work, high quality mixed income housing. We want to deliver housing that is built to high quality market standards. And so that means when you think about it as a real estate developer, we want developers to say, we're going to build high quality housing and we're going to figure out how to make some of it affordable. So there's a difference because most affordable housing developers will say, we're going to make affordable housing and then maybe we'll throw in a few unrestricted units on the top end. Fundamentally different kinds of neighborhoods get built when you have those two different approaches. So we're looking for how do you build great housing and seamlessly include affordability for some of the units rather than do affordable housing. When you do mixed income, you ensure high standards in design, in operation, in development. Everybody gets treated as if they can vote with their feet and leave. And as a result, the lowest income families receive services that they've never had historically. Again, we've talked about attracting additional public and private investment. There's a Publix grocery store in our neighborhood. It's the first grocery store in this community in over 40 years. Had we just done the exact same housing type, but with 100% affordable, we would not have been able to attract a grocery store to the neighborhood. Having rooftops is important, but also rooftops with expendable income. It's how you get the market to invest in the community. And the people who benefit are the lowest income families. And this always breaks my heart to have to acknowledge, but we know that there are teachers and employers who will look at somebody's address and lower their expectations when they see that. So they'll look at a young man's address on their education folder and say, oh, he's from the projects, and say, he can't learn at high levels. Or they'll see a woman who's got an application in for a job someplace, and they'll say, oh, she's from the projects. She's not going to be reliable. This destigmatizes the neighborhood because it recasts it as a neighborhood of choice, and the people who benefit most are the lowest income families. So the second piece, and I think, frankly, the most important piece in terms of breaking the cycle of poverty and sustaining the work long term, is a high quality cradle through college education pipeline that starts with really high quality early learning and transitions into a great rigorous K-12 experience and prepares kids to move forward. About half of the places where we work, those schools are charter schools, and about half are delivered by a traditional public school system under a contract arrangement with a local organization. Let me back up. I'm really agnostic as to your governance structure. Everything that we are doing in Eastlake can be done in a traditional public school if, number one, there's the political will, and number two, there's the commitment to excellence. We don't often see that, and we find it harder to happen in a public school environment than when we work with a public charter school. So I'm not saying it can't happen. In fact, 50% of our folks are working with traditional public schools. But the jury's still out whether those school systems will be successful in moving the needle. It's important that these schools be neighborhood schools, serving the neighborhood. Too often what we see in low-income neighborhoods is somebody builds a great new school that's a magnet school, for example. And kids from all over the city come to this new magnet school, but kids who live in the neighborhood don't get to go to it because they can't test in. And so our goal is to create a neighborhood-serving school system, a neighborhood system of schools that will continue to support people in the neighborhood, and then building that seamless connection between each piece of the pipeline. And that means changing policies and changing practice to make sure that early learning, K-12, and K-12 beyond educators are partnering together with the right social services to make sure everybody is effective. Let me share some of the data. So when we first opened Drew Charter School, our very first year, we were the lowest performing school in the city of Atlanta. We were heartbroken. We were so arrogant. We really thought, oh, 1 year and our kids are going to be at the top of the pack. But what we found out is running a really great school is about the hardest thing there is to do in America. And it took a while in order to get to the highest levels. So let me show you. This is our journey. This is the academic track of every year. Test scores moving up. You see, it's the trend line is always up, but it's not perfect. If the state changes the test scores, then you might see a dip down until we understand what the new criteria with standards were and could adjust our curriculum to make sure we were teaching kids what they needed to know. This is really interesting, though. Right here, about 2009, 2010, when our school got to be one of the very best schools in the city of Atlanta and the state of Georgia, something happened. We started attracting families with choice to the neighborhood. To the school. While we had had an economically diverse community, we did not have an economically and racially diverse school. But when we got here, with a population that was about 80 to 85% free and reduced lunch, the other families in the neighborhood who had economic choice, many of whom were white, said, ah, I want to go to this school too. And so now we have a school that is more economically and more racially diverse. And we think ultimately that's going to be a great thing for kids to go to school with people who come from different backgrounds, who don't all look the same. I think it will prepare kids to be successful in this global economy in which we live. So this is my most favorite chart. This is really, so bear with me while I explain this to you. These schools right across here, Drew, Brandon, Jackson, Morningside, Springdale, et cetera, are the fancy pants schools on the north side of town. These are the schools that everybody knows. These are the best schools in Atlanta. These are the schools you want your child to go to. And there's Drew Charter School right here. So we perform at the same level of all these schools. Here is the average of the state of Georgia right here, and here is the average of the Atlanta public schools. So we're clearly just talking about schools that are at the top of the academic achievement scale. Look at the free and reduced lunch populations of these schools. So Drew Charter School, with a free and reduced lunch population of over 60%, is performing at the same levels of schools that have less than a 20% poverty rate. And here's where it gets really interesting. The average list price, we just went to Zillow or Trulia and pulled off what the average sales prices of houses in the zones that were served by these schools. There's a $1.8 million buy-in to get into some of these neighborhoods. I mean, that might suggest that it's almost not a public school anymore if it costs you $1.8 million to be part of that neighborhood. Nevertheless, I point out that our kids can compete against anybody. Our boys do as good as our girls, and in fact, they're outperforming the girls in middle school right now, and we've never had a program that targets boys. It's the ecosystem has created a healthy environment where all kids can reach their full potential. Our low-income kids outperform the city's non-low-income kids and the state's non-low-income kids. This doesn't happen very often. And we're doing it at scale with, you know, 1,700 kids, not just with a small elite group of 30. Last year we had Boston Consulting Group take a look at our school to say, we think we know what the levers of success are, but we would like you to take a look at it and make sure that we're understanding it. And this is what they came up with. And I share this with you because I think it's important. The single most important determining factor is not going to surprise you. You're all leaders. It's speed of the captain, speed of the crew. If you've got a great principal and a staff who is empowered and has a sense of autonomy and can partner with people from outside of the school, you're set up for success. These embedded traits, embedded professional development, the strong focus on literacy, early learning, early interventions, early and intentional interventions. We use a STEAM curriculum and project-based learning and longer school day and longer school year. Those are all important levers, but without the speed, without the leadership at the top, you won't get there. If you ask the head of school what the most important factor is, he will say it's because we're part of a comprehensive neighborhood revitalization and the school doesn't have to do it all on its own. So you look at all these factors and it creates that great ecosystem for kids to be successful. Third piece, health and wellness. So you want to think about what are the kinds of programs that will bring economic stability to low-income families, but also attract higher wealth families into the neighborhood. You know, I've been a working mom since the day my children were born, and I need exactly the same support that a mom who makes $25,000 a year needs. I need high quality early learning, I need a great school, I need out of school hours care, and I need it to be connected because I can't be running back and forth. You know, here's a great example. Head Start programs typically end, what, at 2:30 during the day? How does that help somebody who you want to go to work? That doesn't make any sense. So we've got, you know, look at all these kinds of policies that don't work to make them work for working families at all income levels. You know, we've got some really wonderful health and recreation partners. I want to give a shout out to the YMCA of Metro Atlanta and the Eastlake Family YMCA. They were the tip of the spear in community building. It was the first place in our community where people came together across race and income and ethnicity to create relations and start to build a sense of community. A place where we came together, got to know each other, and build relationships. It was really important. And you can see some of the other things that are happening here. Now I want to talk just for a minute about the secret sauce, the community quarterback. The community quarterback is absolutely essential. We think this is the difference. This is why Eastlake continues to be more successful today than it was when it first started, why it's more successful than other public housing revitalizations around the country, many of whom who have some of the same pieces, but they don't have this connective tissue between all of the parts. Sometimes I call it the glue and the grease. Sometimes you need partners to be glued together, and sometimes you need to provide a little lubricant between them when there's too much friction. So it's a newly created nonprofit, again, whose only reason for existence is supporting this neighborhood revitalization. High quality, high quality. I can't stress that enough. Too many times, people and organizations working in low-income neighborhoods kind of take a good enough approach. A good enough approach. It's better than people have ever had before. It's good enough. We would say to you, that's not good enough. That the kids and the families who live in the neighborhoods that we care about are only going to get this one chance. And we've got to be excellent at what we do. And we've got to provide excellent opportunities, not good enough opportunities. This is hard to figure out. Braiding funding. You know, there's different funding streams available for education and early learning and housing. And this community quarterback can help the partners figure out what sources are available and then go after them. I want to tell you a couple stories on me when I first started at the Eastlake Foundation. I thought I had the easiest job in America. And I walked in and I walked over to the Early Learning Center that's physically right in the middle of the community. I mean, it could not be any more central. 136 high quality spots with a great provider. And I said, well, how many kids live in the villages of Eastlake, the apartment community surrounding this? And they looked at me and they said, 4. And so I said, well, that's not acceptable. And so what they had done is even though they said they kind of understood the place-based approach, they really didn't. They had not yet changed their policies to say, we are only gonna serve kids in a particular geographic footprint and we won't serve anybody else until we have served everybody in this neighborhood. It took us a couple of years to get them to really drink that Kool-Aid and buy into that paradigm shift. But what that does is it makes sure that kids who live in this neighborhood are getting multiple interventions so that they're on that upward trajectory. Not just a little bit here and a little bit there, but concentrated, focused interventions that are designed to help kids move forward. Had the same issue with the First Tee program. Are you all familiar with the First Tee? Our neighborhood had golf as a historical aspect. The East Lake Golf Club is in the neighborhood. And in fact, if you watch NBC this weekend, you will see the Tour Championship, which is being played at the East Lake Golf Club. And on Saturday, there'll be a couple of stories about Purpose Built and the East Lake Foundation on NBC. But anyway, golf was part of the community, so there was a new public golf course, and every kid was going to learn how to play golf, both as part of the PE program at school, and then on the weekends and part of the first tee program. Well, I walked over Saturday to a first tee class, and I looked up on the driving range. I saw lots of little African-American kids playing golf, and I thought, okay, we're on the right track. And then I started looking at the license plates in the parking lot, and I saw that they were all from other counties. And what I realized is that parents who knew they wanted their kids in the first tee program were willing to drive 30 miles to get their kids in the first tee program, while parents who lived across the street who did not understand that the first tee could be a great experience for their children sat on the sidelines. And so again, we changed the paradigm and we said, the first tee here in Eastlake is only going to serve kids in Eastlake. And you, Mr. Program Director, if you want your program to exist, you need to go out and market to kids who live in this neighborhood whose parents don't yet know they need to be or they should be in this great youth development program. So we changed the paradigm, and our partners had to change policies in terms of who they served, how they served, and how they partnered with other folks. It wasn't just people doing more of the same. It was partners doing things differently in order to get to greater outcomes. So this is kind of what our model looks like filled out in Atlanta. So you see, So you see the East Lake neighborhood here is our defined area, what we're focused on. On the housing piece, you see some of our partners, enterprise community partners, the HUD, the Atlanta Housing Authority, and the private lenders and investors. In the school segment, you see Drew Charter School, Atlanta Public Schools, Sheltering Arms, the Rollins Center for Language and Literacy, Georgia State University, Georgia Tech, and the Atlanta Speech School, just some of the partners. And then over on the health and wellness side, the YMCA, the Eastlake Farmers Market, the First Tee, this is the represents the resident community supported programs. So you see, these are just a few of the partners, but you see with all these moving pieces, how coordination is really important and how creating that architecture to make sure that everybody is working together to create the same opportunities for family is absolutely essential. Up here, here's the Eastlake Foundation. This is Tom Cousins, who founded the Eastlake Foundation, and Danny Choi, who's the president of the Eastlake Foundation, has a job that I used to have, making it all work together for the benefit of the community. People will ask us, what are your preconditions for deciding whether you'll work someplace? And the first one is leadership. Are there leaders from the civic, business, faith community who say, this is a model that we think can work in our community, and we're willing to spend our time at a board level helping to get this going and sustaining it long term? Second, we look, is there an opportunity for high quality mixed income rental housing? Almost every place we work in, by the way, has some component of home ownership, but in terms of neighborhood change and creating places for really low income families to live, mixed income rental is the way to get there fastest. And third, is there an opportunity for site-based control at a local school, whether it's either a charter or with a contract with a traditional public school? And does that school have preference for kids in the neighborhood? Those are the kind of big things that we look for to see whether or not this model works. I should share with you, we don't charge for what we do. We have philanthropic funding that covers our costs. Let me say that again. We don't charge for what we do. If we were to work here with you in Norfolk, we would want you to keep your money here. You don't need to cover our costs. So that's kind of what we look for. It's exciting for us to have a quantifiable, clearly discerned model. It has to be customized in every community. How it gets done in different places doesn't always look like Eastlake. Frankly, some of the places are going to be much better than Eastlake down the road because of what we've learned. And the fact that people are building now on 20 years of experience as opposed to just making it up as we go, which honestly is what we did. So let me share with you Purpose Built's network. We're working now in 13 cities around the country with local leaders. We consider ourselves the coach to the community quarterback and their partners. All of the work is owned and led locally. We're in the background. We're the coordinator. We help the local folks figure out how to coordinate and how to do this. We help them come up with their annual and strategic plans. We'll help them operationalize an annual plan into 90-day goals and then hold people accountable for actually achieving the goals that they said that they want to get to. We'll help them do that. In fact, in a lot of the places where we work, there's not staff hired for the first few months, and so our team often serves as staff for a group that's moving this forward. We've got now probably another 25, and gosh, this slide needs to be updated already, of other places where we're in discussions. We would prefer to go slow with local groups because people see the East Lake presentation, they go, oh yeah, this is what we want. We want one of these. And we want them to want one of these. But the question is whether local leaders are willing to be disruptive enough in order to do this, whether they're willing to work together over a long term across sectors, across industries, in order to be able to get the kind of results and create the kind of platform that will be in place then for a couple of generations to serve families as they work their way up and out of poverty. So, I like this visual. Think about this winding mountain road, and you see twists and turns and people work their way up. People keep falling off the mountain road. They keep crashing, and so the folks who live in this little village are concerned, and so they say, we've got to build a clinic. And so they build a clinic down here. And then more people keep falling off the road because there's a clinic, people come to the neighborhood now, and more people fall off, and so they make a bigger hospital. And more people keep coming, and more people keep falling off, until suddenly you've got a whole bunch of hospitals at the bottom of your road. Wouldn't it have been easier to put guardrails on those curves on the front end and stop people from falling off the cliffs? We think that's what our model is. It's guardrails on the road of life. And it creates opportunities for young people to really meet their full potential in a way that stops them from falling off the cliffs and helps them move forward.